Hi, can I just start by checking how many people here either know what transition is or are involved in a transition initiative? Get a quick hand show. Okay, so quite a few of you already know. I will do a very quick introduction to how transition came about, and then I'll probably move on to the more detail of what's going on at the moment. My name's Peter Lipman. I'm chair of Transition Network, which is a charity which was set up 7 years ago to support the transition movement around the world. And Marcus, who invited me to speak, asked me to give you a quick indication of how it came to be. Can I also just check, can everyone hear me? Can anyone not hear me? Sounds good, okay. So transition came out of a full-time course on permaculture that was being taught in Ireland by a guy called Rob Hopkins. And they were doing quite a lot of looking at what does permaculture mean in a world that's being affected by climate change. And I'm slightly struggling with the Hare Krishna in the background, but anyway. What does transition mean in a world of Hare Krishna? I'm going to give it just 30 seconds, guys. Yeah, you can hear? Okay. And it turned out that just down the road from Kinsale, where... I'm going to just let them go past. Just down the road from Kinsale, where this course was being taught, lived a guy called Colin Campbell, who'd been involved in something called the Association for the Study of Peak Oil, a former oil geologist working for Shell, amongst other companies. And they were talking about the peaking of oil production, which is not running out of oil, of course. It's the peaking in the rate at which we can extract and use oil. And really, transition came out of the combining of what do we do to live more sustainably faced with the climate change issues that we're trying to grapple with, but how do we deal with the double whammy of at the same time being addicted to fossil fuels in so many aspects of our lives in the West, when the easy, cheap availability of those fossil fuels is going to diminish quite rapidly. And the answer that transition seeks to embody is that trying to deal with these sorts of issues on our own as individuals is inherently disempowering, depressing, and bloody difficult. But trying to deal with it as communities, as groups, gives us an opportunity to be creative, and also to find the inner resource, as well as the group resource, with which to face up to these challenges. And that's really how transition was born. How do we enable a group resource to these global challenges? And of course, what's happened over the last 7 years is that the scale of the challenge, whether it's about climate change, whether it's about resource scarcity, whether it's about the economic volatility, which flows from that as well, has simply ratcheted up. And I'm not going to go into the kind of the detail on climate change or peak oil, although I will come back to fracking later. But what's happened at the same time as we've seen this ratcheting up of a challenge is that we've seen an extraordinary growth in the transition movement. When Rob and a friend of mine called Ben Brangwen and I sat down in a coffee shop in Bristol 7 years ago and said, This has started in Totnes, and a couple of other places are saying they're interested. What could we do to support that spread? We were thinking maybe there'll be three or four initiatives in the Southwest in a couple of years. You know, maybe in 4 or 5 years' time, there'll be kind of 10 or 20 initiatives spreading across southern England. And we set Transition Network up, and we've really been on the back foot ever since then, just in time to react to and cope with the level of interest and the speed at which it's spread. So now transition is happening in over 40 countries, and it's happening in an immense variety of ways. And what I want to try and explore a bit in this talk is that kind of variety of ways in which it's happening now, and some of the struggles as well as some of the successes. But I was hoping to really keep my talk to about 10-15 minutes to give lots of time for discussion and question and answer as well. But let's start with sketching some of those differences. I mentioned earlier in another talk about what's happening in Portugal. Transition's taken off in Portugal, in a country which probably of all the countries in Western Europe is struggling most with economic volatility. You know, the same kinds of levels of youth unemployment as in Spain, round about the 50%, the same kind of devastated public welfare systems as you see in Greece, and really people just on the breadline and desperate, and massive currently outward emigration of young people. People with qualifications who see no chance of getting jobs. So transition in Portugal looks completely different to the way it looks here in the UK, because they took a decision quite early on that they were going to try and run everything on a gift economy basis. In other words, they're going to say, we're never going to charge for things unless people feel they can afford to give money. We're going to try and find ways to run all the training, all of the conferences, everything we do, so that people can participate whether or not they've got money. And they also have an enormous focus in Portugal on how do they work with local traders, with local authorities that are faced with just no money. So transition in Portugal looks very different than it does here. And one of the things that happens here in the UK is people say, why is transition so white and middle class? And you talk to someone about Portugal, about whether transition is a middle class movement, and they look at you as if you're a nutcase. They say, of course it's not middle class. Class has got nothing to do with transition in Portugal. In Portugal, it's about how do we live now faced by crisis. And another example of the diversity of this worldwide movement came when I met the people who'd got transition going in Brazil, and who had come to us and said, we want to run a training in the favelas of Sao Paulo, but all of your trainings assume that people are literate, which of course they do. And of course it had never struck us as educated Westerners to think about that. So the people in Brazil took the training and they said, right, this is a fantastic process, we want to use it in the favelas, but we're not going to assume literacy. And I was absolutely amazed to see that a process that we had kind of half invented, half experimented with as we were inventing it, which was really designed for communities that quite often had far too many possessions and far too little solidarity and communal spirit, was working so well in the favelas of Sao Paulo, where they have masses of solidarity and really very little in the way of possessions. So there's something about a process which assumes that people can find dignity and power through working together, through looking at questions communally, and saying we as communities can decide how we respond to that. Something in that which seems to have transcended national norms, transcended so many things. You know, it's worked really well in Japan, and that feels like such a different culture to me. But it was already working before Fukushima, and post-Fukushima there's been an enormous blossoming of transition focused around what do we do about the production of energy in a country like Japan, where everything has been focused around big top-down nuclear, etc. energy. You know, an enormous picking up, turning to this because it's a community process. And those are the sorts of things which actually start to give me more and more hope that we, as kind of almost inevitably fairly limited in our power individuals, that we can find a process that enables us to respond proportionately to the scale of the challenges that we're facing. So, you know, if you think about climate change, and the fact that we're at over 400 parts per million, and we probably need at the very least to get down to under 350 parts per million, then can any of us hope to do that as individuals? No. Will it happen if we just do it as isolated communities? Obviously not. But can we, coming together as more and more communities, start to not only produce our own energy and consume within the boundaries of that production, but can we start to influence the big top-down systems that are producing energy? Well, at least we have a chance of doing that. I don't know if we can yet, but we're having more and more influence on future planning. The fact that the Department for Energy and Climate Change, which for a long time refused to accept any meaningful role for community energy in its response to the Climate Change Act, now actually is designing a community energy strategy and talking about what possible role could communities play, that shows the beginning of a shift in consciousness at the top-down level as well as the bottom-up level. That shift in consciousness is very fragile and endlessly difficult. In my role in liaising with DEC, I realise over and over again the gap between an official pronouncement about what could or should happen, and then what actually happens. And if you were to just look, for example, at the recently published visits by lobbyists into DEC and look at the sheer number of visits from the big electricity producers, the big oil companies into DEC, and compare that with the time that they put into a community energy strategy, you know, it doesn't mean it's going to be easy. But there is an opening there. There's a beginning of a chance to shape things. Sorry, DEC's the Department for Energy and Climate Change. So it's good points. Please stop me if I use jargon like that. So it came together out of basically the government department that is responsible for nuclear energy, amongst other things, and parts of the old environment department. And it's a strange mixture, I have to say. So what's happening at a global level as well, it's not just transition appearing in more and more countries, more and more places, it's also a fascinating and actually rather scary reaction from the charitable foundations and other organisations that are trying to find a way to respond to the crisis that we're facing. And at the moment, I've been talking to some large and very rich American foundations from something called the Environmental Grantmakers Association in the US about what are they doing about climate change, because they're sitting on enormous amounts of money and they don't know what to do with it. Everything they've funded so far by way of reaction to climate change seems to just skim over the top. And there are two really interesting things about that. The one is that, from what I can understand from my conversations with them, their thinking is that they now have a window of a year to 5 years to do something meaningful about climate change before they shift their efforts from mitigation into adaptation. In other words, for those of you that aren't familiar with that jargon, they shift their efforts from trying to say, can we do something to reduce climate change, into saying, we're going to put our money into working out how we best live with it, as bad as it might be. And I'm really scared when I hear that, because I completely understand that we have to live with it, whatever it delivers us. But the moment we give up on trying to reduce it, we open up a doorway into a quite unimaginable future. The other thing that's fascinating about this Environmental Grantmakers Association, and these are things like the Rockefeller Foundation, the Ford Foundation, these are not exactly bastions of international communism, is that they're now starting to question whether you can do something meaningful about things like climate change, social justice, all of those issues, with a capitalist system. And that's really fascinating to me. When we start to see those kind of massively established foundations question whether you can make meaningful change in this world under a capitalist system. And that was partly what I wanted to come back to now, which is, what's the role of transition in a capitalist system where basically we have a money system which is based on debt, which predicates then endless growth in order to repay that debt. We have a system which leads at the moment to ever increasing amounts of inequality. And, you know, transition is a community-based response to these issues that, to me, assumes a focus on equality, on communal access to resources, rather than access to resources being rationed by how much money you have. What does that mean for a transition movement? And particularly, what does that mean for a transition movement in the context of rapid change? Does that mean that we have to all get involved in explicitly political change? And this was, again, following on from a discussion that we had in the tent earlier. And it came up in the context of fracking. So people in transition are promoting positive alternatives. Community-produced energy, living within the energy we can produce. What do we do if people are starting to frack on our doorsteps? And this is happening for me in Bristol, because there's potential fracking in Keynsham. And this becomes really problematic for me, because while I deeply love the fact that transition is trying to reach out to everyone, saying we need to react to these challenges as communities, and that means not excluding anyone, if someone is then saying, yeah, but Quadrilla are about to frack on your doorstep and possibly mess up your water supplies for the next 10,000 years, I'm not going to ignore that. And that's the kind of tension that's happening more and more, I think, and will happen more and more for us in transition. As we grow and become more visible, we get faced with these sorts of issues. If we're kind of insignificant, then we don't really get faced with the issues. If we're going to do something meaningful, we're going to be significant, we're going to be visible, and we're going to get faced with these sorts of issues. And I think fracking is a big one. I think as well the kind of the mixture of opportunity and threat offered by the government's current approach to localism is another one. So more and more under the Localism Bill or Act and the associated acts, we see power potentially being passed to communities to act for themselves. But that's being done at the same time that we're seeing extraordinary cuts being posed on local authorities. And of course, one of the things that local authorities, councils were there to do was to provide a safety net for people. And if that safety net is being cut, and we're just seeing the beginning of those cuts, I mean, you know, things that we've all assumed would be made available for communities are going to be taken away. What's the role of a transition initiative in response to that? Are we going to kind of step in and put a sticking plaster over it? Or are we going to say, no, we can't prop that up? I'm not standing up here with answers to that, because actually, transition as a bottom-up movement, what will happen is there'll be more and more discussion about these issues, and I'm hoping we'll move on to that discussion in a minute. But the thing that gives me hope at the moment, the thing that gives me a feeling of meaning and joy in my life, is the feeling that as these stresses and fractures show more and more in the system that we're part of, more and more people are asking these kind of questions and looking to answer them communally. Thank you. So I was hoping we could move on to more of a discussion than me kind of standing up here talking on my own. Have we got a roving mic? Or do we just talk loudly? No roving mic. No, well. Look, it's on a wire. Just shout. Yeah.
I think it's amazingly impressive what the transition movement has achieved in the last few years, and really profound congratulations. And clearly the timing was good, but without the ideas being strong as well, it wouldn't have happened that way. I would like to address this question of, on the one hand, community action, but on the other hand, enabling some of the action to take place by policy beyond the community. I mean, you briefly talked about how you're talking to the Department of Energy and Climate Change. You know, we in the previous discussion talked about how without feed-in tariffs, renewable energy wouldn't have happened in the way that it has, firstly in parts of Europe, but increasingly now. Thank you. Increasingly now also in Britain, though obviously the Cameron government has then turned down the policy. So I think obviously it is critically important to have both, and I think without that interaction between national policy initiatives and local community initiatives of the kind that transitions stand for, we're not going to accelerate the speed of change, as was again a topic in the last discussion, to the extent that we need. At the same time, we also know how the current system is deeply compromised by its connections with industry, with interests, financial interests of the kind that ultimately is opposed to the kind of initiatives that the transition stands for. So the key question is how to interact between community and nation state and beyond.
Thank you. Do people want to make two or three comments or questions and then I'll respond? Could you just say what your name is too? It's just nice to know.
Yeah, my name is Derek. I was just wondering, with an organisation which is, not an organisation, but I don't know what we can call it actually, a movement which is moving so quickly, you know, Is there a problem that you might become too dispersed and lose the essential message? Is there a mission statement or values that, you know?
One more?
Hi, my name's Greg. I'm from Bristol, and you'll be aware what's happening in Bristol at the moment is that we've recently had a mayor elected, a very competent person who's pushing through a residence parking scheme the purpose of which is to reduce the amount of commuter traffic and pollution in the city, which is a very laudable aim, and to get people reducing the addiction to the motor car onto public transport. However, the way that the mayor's gone about it is he's alienated some of the areas, many of the areas in the city. So there's a really fascinating discussion going on at a sort of grassroots level amongst citizens in the city. And a lot of that's happening on Facebook about what's the next stage. And I've noticed and observed how that discussion is evolving. So first of all, it started to be, I don't want this residence parking in my street.